Oh, I loved it. I loved a t-shirt. Are you kidding me? And my last t-shirt my dad stole from me. He's so funny. Oh. Well, I love the work I do because I want women to take good care of themselves so that they have healthy babies and that they stay healthy to raise their babies. It's been a long time doing this. When I was in college, I had some very interesting summer jobs. One of my summer jobs was working in a woman's shelter in New York City. And one of the biggest problems I encountered there was people would come and sit and they'd go, "Oh, why should we listen to you? How can you help us? You're not an adult." And I would say, "What do you mean I'm not an adult? I'm like 10 years older than you are. You haven't had a baby." And to be in a culture where you're not an adult until you've had a child, even though you're in a homeless shelter now, is something I found incredibly intriguing. And one of the things that came out of that was that I felt like people didn't have access to birth control. And if women had better access to birth control, then they would realize that really one of the other aspects of being an adult is getting to actually have an adult life. Because these women were basically farmed out to make babies. They would live with their moms and their moms would send them out. They'd get pregnant. They'd leave the baby with mom and then they'd be sent out to get pregnant again. They didn't really have adult lives. So I thought, well, if I could change that, what that one little piece, if I could change that one little piece, then maybe it would make a difference to someone. Might not make a difference to a whole slew of people, but even if it only helped a few people, I'd feel like I was doing something. I couldn't do things the normal way, which means that you go to high school and then you go find a college where you go study biology or chemistry. I ended up kind of getting burnt out in high school, went to the Bronx High School of Science and got burnt out with spending a lot of time with geeky science people and ended up going to a small liberal arts college in Annapolis, Maryland called St. John's. And it's the Great Books program. So there are no tests, there's no lots of paper writing and lots of speaking. And it was a little hard to get into medical school after that. So I had to do a post-bac program. I did that at Goucher, right above Baltimore. And showed them I actually could do science. But still, it was not terribly easy to get into medical school. I ended up getting into medical school at Albany Med, which kind of has great pride in the fact that they don't have a traditional group of students there. So started there and ended up here because that's where I could get a residency. But I wanted to stay up here anyway because I love Central New York. It reminded me of a little bit of, it's not totally close, but my grandparents grew up and raised their whole families in Vermont. So Central New York was a lot more like Vermont than New York City was, and I wanted out of New York City. Well, I think the hardest thing was everyone was much younger than I was. So, and they were very interested in grades, getting an A in biochemistry and getting an A in that. And people weren't very good at communicating with others. They're very good about taking tests, but they weren't very good about seeing the other side of a story. They didn't always understand why patients, when we're doing our clerkships, why patients didn't always want to, well, why didn't they want to follow what the doctor said? Well, maybe they wanted to explain to the doctor what was important to them, and then maybe we could have a conversation of where the treatment plan should go. And but that kind of communication does not come easily to a lot of people, especially when you've been isolated and just been doing a lot of research and a lot of testing and a lot of, and not a lot of talking and getting out and just understanding people.
Right.
It was definitely the human aspect. And since I was older, female, and I wanted to keep talking about the human aspect of medicine, that made it very hard on me. I think, again, when you're doing clerkships, people just, when you're doing medical school, a lot of medical school back then, and you have to remember this was 25 years ago, they just didn't talk about ethics. They didn't talk about cultures and trying to understand how medicine is different in different cultures and how we need to understand, well, you know, maybe that person, what you're asking them, for instance, you know, there's some people feel like postpartum, if you drink cold fluids, that's bad for you. Well, we're always encouraging people to drink water after they deliver. No, I can hot water, not cold water. And so those are things you're not going to understand unless you ask people and sit down and talk to them and try to understand where they're coming from. And even if where they're coming from doesn't make sense to you, they're not going to listen to any of the things that you want them to do if there isn't a communication. I'll do this, but I need to do this too. You can't just say, I'm going to do it my way, or the highway. Or you end up with people not doing anything that you want them or need them to do to help with their care. So.
And then your patient numbers go down.
Well, it's not just your patient numbers go down, but you're here to help people get better. And that treatment plan has to be a mutually agreed upon treatment plan, not I'm the doctor, I'm telling you, you have to do it this way. It can't be paternalistic. But it's much easier when you're young and only used to taking tests to just want to be paternalistic. I think one of the nicest things that's happened in the last 30 years is the fact that medical schools are trying to incorporate ethics, different cultures, into actually the training, because most of that training happened in our generation on our own. We had to figure out those things ourselves the hard way. Well, I think the office, we try very hard to make a more holistic approach. So yes, we're here to make sure that people have their GYN exams, which means we do breast exams and we do pap smears and the like, but it also has to do with the fact that people come in now, and we're talking a lot about the fourth trimester now. And what that really means is that a lot of people, it used to happen that women would come in, they'd have their babies, and we wouldn't see them until they had a complication in their 50s. They'd come in with vaginal bleeding because they had cervical cancer or something terrible like that. And there would be stretches of 15, 20 years where we wouldn't see them. Now we're trying to make people see that your health just isn't, you can't just be healthy when you're pregnant. You have to be healthy the rest of the time in order to take care of your kids and yourself and your husband and mom and dad and the whole works. And that means looking at the things that happen during pregnancy and realizing, if I have gestational diabetes or preeclampsia in pregnancy, I'm at risk for heart disease in my 40s. And earlier than I would have been had I not had those things. So The office is really trying to gear itself up to teach people that those things have to be watched out for and that we have to mitigate the other things that may also happen, like you should be watching your cholesterol, you should be watching your weight, you should be, and no one ever talked about that 25, 30 years ago. It was like, oh yeah, you have a little baby fat. It's okay. It's not okay. It's just, it's not okay anymore. And part of that is probably stems from the fact that we ride around in our cars all the time. I mean, 20 years ago, not everybody had cars. They walked more places. They walked to where they grocery shop. They walked to kids' schools. Now everybody hops in the car. We're realizing that as a subspecialty, that there are things we have to embrace. We have to embrace the fact that we're the first line people to see a lot of women and that we're the only people to see a lot of women for a long time. Most people don't have a, in their reproductive age, don't have a GYN and say a primary care, unless they have some really serious medical problems. So that, yes, but I think that women's health should have always incorporated those things. It should have always had a thought of, we're just not here to keep you from getting diseases. We're here to keep you healthy. Because then probably you wouldn't have all the diseases that you have. And part of that comes from living in America the way America is right now. I don't think we need to concentrate as much on this, probably in European places where I think in general they're healthier than we are. I suppose it is, we're incorporating more of the general practitioner, but I think it's something that have always should have been part of women's health, just like screening people for depression after pregnancy should have always been something that we were doing. Well, I think the biggest challenge right now is maternal morbidity. And what that simply means, that's a big word, but what that means is in America, in one of the wealthiest nations in the world, women are still dying in childbirth. And we haven't really made a dent in that. With all the money we put into healthcare, the people, women are still dying at an incredible rate. So I think the next step and what a lot of people like me and hospitals in the country are working on is how do we have what we call birth equity, which means that everybody gets good care and everybody knows they're going to leave the hospital healthy with a healthy baby. Again, I think a lot of that has to do with understanding where women come from and listening to them. The biggest thing we can do is listen to people. And I think sometimes we think we're listening, but we listen to what we want to hear and then we don't hear the rest. And we have to learn to do a better job because the statistics are dreadful. So I think that's one of the biggest things. I think the other thing is making healthcare, finding a niche so that people who don't understand necessarily who they are or where they're going find a place so that they can still get good care. I mean, people may be born one way and want to be another way. And a lot of places, there's no place for them, a safe place for them to investigate where they really want to go. One of the things we're trying to do with birth equity is to gather data. So we try to make our surveys the data that we collect culturally sound, which essentially just means that when you get information, In the old days, we didn't want to identify where did the information come from, and now it's really important. So how many preeclamptics were Caucasian? How many preeclamptics were the people of color? This is the kind of information we have to know. How many people, and you didn't used to do that. You just were happy with, okay, we have this many people who are preeclamptic in the practice, and we had this many people or this. You need to understand, because that's the only way you're going to make a dent in birth equity. And we're trying to do that by taking what we know and not just working in this little community called, Kathy J. Berry and Associates, because that's not enough data. So we need to broaden things, and we need to work on it on a hospital level. We need to work on it on a county level, on a state level, because that's the only way we're going to see bigger pictures. And I think a lot of doctors, they want to come to work. They have enough with just doing what they're doing in their practice. And I think we have to understand that as a group, that the only way to make a difference is to combine all of the data, all of the knowledge together in a bigger circle, And that's not easy for us, because we like our little circles in medicine. We don't like our bigger circles. Our bigger circles make us feel, oh, you're political. It's not being political. It's understanding that the only way for communities to get better is to reach out and be part of the community. You can't fix something sometimes when you have such tunnel vision in just one practice.
Is there a question I haven't asked you that you would like to answer? Something I didn't say or talk about today that you'd like to address?
Yeah, there is. I've always wanted to talk about this, so I'll talk about this now. So, because I don't think the last time we talked about this. This is a kind of an offside of the listening thing. I think that sometimes doctors are in a big hurry because they have 15 minutes, you have your 15 minutes, and they have a tendency to peg people in little holes. You put the person here, and put the person here, and put the person here. And because that gets you out of the room faster and to the next patient, when sometimes we have to read between the lines. And so I'm going to tell a very personal story about reading between the lines. My sister died at a very young age. Do you know this? Okay. My sister died at a very young age. 46 is way too young to be dying when you have a 12-year-old child to take care of and single mom and things like that. And my sister died from AIDS. And when my sister passed away, I got a phone call in the locker room at Krause, and it was her primary physician. And he was calling me to apologize. And I said, so why are you saying you're sorry to me? I mean, I'm sorry, too. She passed away, and thank you for, your condolences. And he goes, no, I'm sorry. And I said, what do you mean you're sorry? He goes, I never asked the right questions. I said, what do you mean you never asked the right questions? You've been her primary physician for years. You're the one who diagnosed her rheumatoid arthritis. You're the one who did. What do you mean you didn't ask the right questions? He goes, I put her in a hole, and I just assumed that because she was the child of ministers, that she had this sort of life. I never asked her about her sex life. I never asked her who her recent partners were. I never asked her, did she practice safe sex? I never asked her the right questions. And she was probably trying to tell me things, but I wasn't listening because it didn't come out to fit the picture of the person that I imagined her to be. And I have to tell you, I'm sorry. I said, well, thank you very much, but don't call my parents and tell them the same thing, because they'll be devastated. But I said, I hope you learn from this. I hope you learn that each patient is a fresh page. And when they come in and sit down with you, they're not their past, they're not their future, they're the person that you have right here. And it said right in her intake, she was separated from her husband. So what should have been the first question you asked? I said, it's really sad when the only person who finally got her to do a test, 7 years after she'd probably been exposed, was the ophthalmologist who was treating her for ocular herpes, who couldn't make it go away and finally said, wait a second, there's something wrong with this picture. I said, you knew her since she was a child almost. You've been taking care of her since she was 21. And you don't ask people those questions when they come in for care, like, who are you sexually active with? Are you using protection? Who are they? Have they ever used IV drugs? Have they, you know, you didn't take the time to ask the right questions, and you didn't take time to listen to what was in between your questions. So I hope that's what people do, because I think a lot more people would get tested, get treatment, if the door was open for them and they felt comfortable and they didn't feel like they were being thought about in an unkind way because they weren't living the lives their parents lived. No, I still think how I show my pride is to listen so that everyone gets the care they need. And, you know, and sometimes the listening it's not easy. I mean, we had someone come in who's a friend of one of the midwives, and she sat down and said, I like the practice, but you have to change all your intake forms. But we have intake forms now that say, okay, what did you identify at birth as? What do you identify now as? Who do you feel comfortable having sex with? And it was a big educational thing for the staff. Again, you don't get trained 25 years ago in medical school at this, and I hope they train people now to, you know, ask people, what would you like to be called, and what pronoun would you like to use for your, and but if that makes people feel comfortable coming here, then I want to do that, because I want people the thing that I hate most is when I find out someone gets sick because they didn't feel comfortable getting what I call preventative care. And that's what America should be about, preventative care. Not we fix the disease after it's happened. It's not there.